What a difference a day makes. I'm looking around with the B camera, and of course there's Marty, who's standing in the middle of everything, and this is busy. So I've been in the TAPR forums all morning. It is noon. We'll take a look at the lines for food and stuff like that. Hey, say again?
Good job, Gary. You're doing a great job. You always do.
Are you one of my biggest fans?
Oh, you got that right.
Did you slip Arvin some money over in the building
six? Absolutely. Absolutely. I tickled the pig. How you been?
Okay, who are you?
Jim Measy. I'm New York City, Long Island section manager. It's a long word like that. W2K of is my
call. Okay, so I'm in the presence of celebrity.
Oh, no, I'm not a celebrity. I'm an also ran. I'm just one of the boys, that's all. But they gave me a title.
So you've been a Dayton regular, haven't you?
Yes, yes.
What do you think?
The jury's still out yet. I'm still kind of figuring, it's a nice venue. The rain's a pain. Traffic coming in was a pain today. But it's not bad. It's no mold, you know, a couple of things. Harrah was nice. That was a nice place.
So once you got past the traffic, which I understand was really bad.
It's fine. It's fine. The building's a little warm right now, but I think there's ways to adjust it. I'm working in the ARRL booth, the expo booth. It's great, but it's small. And it's a little tight in there, and we have a lot of people going in there looking at books and trying to get information, DXCC card checking and all that. And they're doing a great job.
So I haven't been over there. They're not doing an expo type thing this year?
Well, it is an expo, but it's really downsized. It's downsized a lot, but they're doing a great job. There's a lot of people over there all the time.
So. Okay, an expo light.
Yeah, expo light.
All right, thank you, Jim.
Thanks, Gary.
All right, so our first man on the street. So there's some lines over there for the food booths. It's noon. It smells really good out here, doesn't it, Marty?
Smells like oil that's been fried and fried and fried.
Yeah.
You know, all these hams and they're oily, greasy.
I can barely hear you. We're a little ways apart. Here's the deal. I was going to let these guys in on the deal, and then we were just going to do a little play acting. Try to butt in line. Because it's a pretty long line here. But you said don't let them know.
We're not going to let them know.
We're not going to let them
know. We're just
going to
do this.
We're just going to see what happens. So let's find out. Excuse me, guys. We're the media. Can we get in line in front of you? Because we're in a big hurry.
Yeah, you can get in line. Yeah. Right back there is where the line starts.
He's one to say he crashed the line.
Oh, he butted in line.
Yeah, he crashed the line.
Okay. So how long have you been waiting here?
Probably about, a half hour, 45 minutes in line.
All right.
Almost as long as it took us to get from downtown Xenia up into the parking spot. But other than that, it's been great. I think it's a great venue compared to Hare Arena, really. I really do. It's been a pleasant experience.
But the line for food, first of all, how did you pick this one?
Because that's where he wanted to go. I would have picked a different one, but he picked the longest line, said it's got to be the best food because it's the longest line, right?
It all smells real good, and I think you got to place your order.
Oh, yeah, I know.
And I'm not really going to butt in line.
Okay.
I'm going to butt in front of these guys. Can I butt in? I'm from the media.
Hello, hello.
Can I butt in line? I'm from the media.
I don't know. It depends on which media.
Ham Radio Now.
That's okay.
He's letting me in. I'm not really going to do it.
Okay.
So how did you pick this line?
Followed him. I just went to the back of the line. It was. It's been more than a half hour.
There's a whole bunch of trucks here. How'd you pick this one?
That's good. I like steak.
Oh, okay, good. Who are you?
Ray DeVroot, K6LJ.
Are you from Six Land?
No, Texas. Originally from Six Land.
Okay, you did a minus one. You're down to Five Land.
I'm down to Five Land.
All right, good talking to you. Have fun.
Thank you.
All right, so they were actually pretty much too nice to me, except for the first guy in line there, who I think he figured out what was going on. Marty, you're never paying attention to the show.
I'm not paying attention, that's for sure. I was just watching somebody on Facebook Live, and then I turn around.
His head's a swivel head.
And they're behind me.
What's behind you?
The people on Facebook Live, so that's pretty cool.
Oh, we're on Facebook Live.
They are. There's people back there.
Oh, they
I got
are.
The notification.
Is it Katie over there or someone
no,
else?
No, it's Tim Duffy, K3LR.
Hello from the Dayton Hamvention in Xenia, Ohio.
Oh, okay.
DX Engineering. But we'll be back.
We'll be back. Oh, we're going to go somewhere else. We'd like to eat, but we can't wait long enough, and they won't let us in.
Yeah. I guess we're just going to have to go hungry.
Didn't get very far before I ran into my cameraman from the last big field day, which is now...
The sound man.
The sound man. I guess I did the camera, didn't I?
Yes. Yeah, I was the accidental star is the word you're looking for.
You stood there with the boom?
Yes.
With the mic that was flopping on the end of it?
Yes.
And then one of the guys up there fixed it for us?
Yeah, KA3EJJ went in his van and...
We had a problem with the bracket for our boom mic. Maurice had the tools and took the time to fix it for us.
Eureka! It's fixed!
I'm sure it's still holding today as we speak.
I haven't seen it
in your garage.
Well, it's not mine. It belonged to the soundtracks, companies I freelanced at. So, was this the beginning of a burgeoning television career for you?
No, that was the beginning and the end of a burgeoning television career, unfortunately.
All right. So, what do you think of... you've been to the Hera Arena a lot. What do you think of this now?
There are improvements, big improvements. There are, you know, it's a step backward in a few ways. It's gonna take some time. It's some growing pains, but so far it looks like a great time. You know, the attendance looks like it's excellent.
Can you point out one or two improvements and one or two steps back?
The food seems to be universally better. The food at Hera was always very industrial. Maybe is the way to go, and. I don't know, the flea market experience is going to be a little bit more of an adventure, perhaps. After they get a good rain on the mud that's already out there, it's going to be a little bit sloppy.
All right, so here's the big question I'll ask about the current venue. Will you come back next year?
Planning on it, yeah. The attraction of Dayton is not the venue, per se. It's the people, and it's getting to see the friends that you only see in person once a year, if that, so... I'll come back.
All right. Thank you, Chris.
Thanks, Gary. Take care.
All right. Now, wait a minute. Have you got somebody to talk to there?
I don't know. Are we going to talk?
All right. So we're checking out what people think of the Hamfest.
So far, so good. Could use a little more lighting in the tents. They're a little dark, but other than that, not bad. Everything's good so far.
Okay. So did you have to fight traffic to get in?
We had about a mile back up about 7:45 this morning when we were out there, but we got in, parked.
Okay, and I figured out the question that I'm going to ask everybody, which will really analyze the Hamfest. You planning on coming back next year?
Yes. Yeah, so far so good. Unless something happens between now and the weekend, we're doing good.
And what could possibly go wrong?
It's ham radio, you can never know. But I do know one thing is that we have if you'd like to come over and take a shot of the roosters.
Roosters?
Yeah, the rooster... 39.90 every morning, 6 a.m. I'm doing it for 57 years without missing a net.
Oh, so you own that frequency?
I don't know. No, nobody owns a frequency at all. Absolutely not.
Yeah. I hear that.
No.
Okay, tell me who you are.
I'm Greg, WA3GM.
Where are you from?
Right outside of Philadelphia, a place called Ambler, PA.
All right, good talking to you, Greg.
Okay, thanks. Nice to talk to you.
Maybe we can get out of here. I don't know.
Word on the street with Gary Pierce.
Yeah.
Up next.
Okay, if we don't get waylaid, we're going to go into Maxim Hall here. This is where we went yesterday and saw what it looked like. We're being photobombed. Who are you?
Oink.
Oink. Okay.
We have a pig.
Oh, so you know him. And we know him.
Who? My father.
Oh,
I'm so sorry.
Okay, now I know what's going on here.
Exactly.
I'm being ganged up on.
Exactly. Well, I see the resemblance.
Of course.
It's the infamous Don Wilbanks.
Yes.
From a variety of media.
Yes.
The king of all ham radio media.
Oh, I wouldn't go that far. Crown Prince, perhaps.
I have declared, however, that Ham Radio Now is the most important ham radio program on the internet.
I've heard that rumor.
Yeah.
I've heard that rumor.
Now, can I get you to agree on camera?
Agree with what?
The statement, Ham Radio Now is the most important amateur radio program on the internet.
I will agree that I've heard that.
And it is a statement.
I will agree that I've...
We,
I will agree that I've heard that
now?
Statement.
Okay.
I will agree that I've heard you state that.
I believe we've reached a Donald Trump moment.
I think so. It's an impasse.
Yeah, so you having fun?
I am. Yeah, we're having fun getting used to the new venue and the lack of air conditioning, which is interesting. But, you know... Yeah, it's not bad. And my son Tyler, he's He's walking around. If you've seen him, you probably saw him earlier. He was in a pig suit.
I was in the forum all morning, so I missed the pig suit, but I guess you're glad to be out of that.
Well, our friend Neil Rapp, who does Ham Talk Live, has him in
his
a Ham Talk
most
Live.
Important
yes,
ham radio program
him,
on the internet.
Has him in a pig suit, walking around a Ham Talk Live pig suit. So yeah, that's been kind of fun. So yeah, no, it's it's a new place. It's a learning experience for everyone. So yeah, I think it's going to be a good thing. I'm enjoying myself.
We're being photobombed again.
Oh, sorry.
Shocker.
Is this important? Sorry.
No, it's not now.
Where's your pig suit? I got it. I'm on my break.
Wait a minute, Emmett. You can't just walk in here, do that, and go away.
How you doing?
So Don, interview Emmett.
Hello, Don.
Hello, Emmett.
On Ham Radio Now.
And now we're done.
And now we're done on Ham Radio
right.
Now.
We're standing in front of the camera.
For those of you who may not know, it's Emmett Hohensee, W0QH, is that it? That's it, W0QH. Some of the best wire antennas on the planet.
Thank you.
My distinct pleasure and honor to use those antennas.
Thank you.
Good stuff. I love
them. Don is one of my test dummies. I mean,
yes. Yeah.
He's one of those guys that knows how to burn them up. And
well, no. Me and lightning. Yeah, I had a little help from Mother Nature.
But he's also one that gives me good input too, which is
exactly.
Always fun.
So I saw you're over by the ICOM MCOM van. That's cool with your antenna up there on the mast. What do you think of the new venue and everything that's going on here?
The very big positives are it's a bigger open space. Mm-hmm. People aren't as crowded as they used to be in Hera Arena. A lot of the smells and environment that used to be in Hera Arena are no longer here.
Right.
You know, there are some, you know, there are a couple detractors, but, you know, the one thing I know about the committee here is that they're dedicated to make sure that whatever didn't go right this year,
right.
They're going to try and make it work better next year.
And the thing I think that people have to understand is that DARA, in particular, and all of the attendees in general who have been coming here for decades, they knew Hera like the back of their hand.
Yep.
Because all of the major stuff was in the same place every year.
Right.
And there were you know, various ways of getting in and out of that area.
Right.
Everything has changed.
Yes. It's
everything
a new venue.
Has changed. It's the other side of the coin, and it's a new venue. It's limited ways in and out, which, you know, can't really do a whole lot about that.
Nope.
We've got brand new venues. We're having to relearn everything. But, you know, it's
but the thing is,
it's a good thing.
Look at the food court.
Oh,
God. There's food everywhere.
It's nice food.
It's almost like we're going to a food tasting, convention kind of a thing.
I know. I have to find the beer stein. I have to find
which
the
beer. I
saw
when you find it, let me know. I'll come visit with you. But the other part is that, like I said, they're working really hard to make things work.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's open, which I like. I mean, you got this bigger space.
Yeah.
We're not bumping into everybody like we used to.
Right.
And it's like you tried to go down one aisle. You can't. But the aisles are a lot wider. It's cleaner. And I just like the open campus. Mm-hmm. So.
And we're getting a little vitamin D, courtesy of...
Yeah, me. I'm
exactly.
Turning brown today.
Get a little color.
I'm becoming a raisinette.
Exactly. There you go. Well, Emmett, thank you so much
thank you, Don. It's good seeing you again.
For stopping in and bumping into us here on Amateur Radio Now, according to Gary.
Ham Radio Now.
Thank you, Gary.
Ham Radio Now.
Just read it right off the mic flag.
Ham Radio
Now.
Gary, it's Ham Radio Now.
It's important.
TV.
It's fairly important.
Yes.
The most important ham radio program on the internet.
On the internet, as we speak.
That's what I've heard.
Yes. Thank you very much.
That's not live.
And your son has taken over the camera.
Of course. That's what he does.
We'll catch you guys later. Thank you.
Thanks, Emmett.
See you, brother.
You're getting me out of work. What are you doing?
No, I'm not here.
I think you're a traitor here. You're trying to sabotage?
No.
No? You're retired.
I'm
retired. You at the Newsline booth?
I was.
You were?
Yeah.
Real you and paper you, right?
We're looking. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. We're looking for. It was me and my evil twin, Lon.
Yeah, Lon.
We're looking for ICOM now.
So, are you Lon or are you Don?
One never knows.
Yeah, I don't know.
Pretty much interchangeable. We're gonna go visit with ICOM and find.
Never heard of them. What did they do?
I don't know.
Yeah.
And find something to eat.
You can. They sell radios that are pretty good there.
That's what I understand.
Yeah, they taste good.
Wait a minute. You're going to ICOM to find something to eat?
Exactly.
No, we're going to ICOM and we're going to find something.
He's going to eat at ICOM.
I wonder if ICOM is how they. I should ask Ray about this, about like iPhone, everything else from Apple, ICOM.
Well, it's a name. It's not I-COM. I mean,
yeah. They were first.
Say something intelligent.
I hungry.
I tired.
I want lunch.
All right.
I think we're done.
Say hi to George and Bob for me.
I'll do it when I see him.
I've already seen Gordon.
I haven't seen him yet. Yeah, I saw Gordon. I haven't seen him yet. But yeah, we will when we see him.
So we've been here for a while, but I think we want to see the inside. You want to see the inside.
We're trying to go inside.
You want to see the inside. We're going to the inside.
We've seen it all already from inside the pig suit.
Yeah, so let's go.
All right.
We'll see you in a minute.
See you, Don. There's our newest cameraman.
Yeah, he's been doing green screen video for me.
Still trying to get in this building.
We're really struggling.
We may make it. We've only got a few feet to go.
Let's see. We're gonna make it. You know, this feels like a little bit like what I would expect. I had a pretty weird idea as to what I think this would be like, but hey, you know, the place is full. I haven't seen any major complaints. It's a little warm in here. It's a little dark in here. Something I've heard a lot about this place is a little bit dark. But look, we are in building one, I believe. And we kind of got here yesterday. You probably saw that in the old video, the intro video we did yesterday. But this building has Kenwood in it. That's the vendor in this building. And Viroplex is here. And MFJ is another big one here. Stepper. Rowan, as we see behind us. And I'm content with this place. I came in being a little bit nervous, but this building is pretty neat, and we're going to go around here, and maybe we'll talk to a few people. But so far, noon update, things are going good. And now, breaking news, we go to the Kenwood booth, where we see well, let's take a look here right now, and nothing. Another year, Kenwood, you dropped the ball. They have, like, it's funny, they have four of the same radios on their display cases, thinking, like, it makes it look special. They take literally the same radio, and then the square is a box of four of them. I don't know why. Seems kind of weird if you ask me, but their HF line has not changed. Their VHF line has not changed. They're still trying to plug their D-Star radio from last year, but I don't know. We haven't seen a HF radio out of Kenwood in a long time.
They're waiting for their SDR to come out of the lab.
Yeah, well, it's gonna be a while knowing them.
Well, next year.
Next year, maybe we'll judge you again next year, Kenwood.
Yeah, but from Kenwood, no may surprise.
No surprises.
Next. And we are here in front of the Ham Radio 2.0 booth. With my Orlando buddy Jason.
Right.
And apparently, you're giving away free money.
Yeah, I am. Yeah.
So anybody just come by and grab some of that.
I actually got that idea from you.
But I do it with a piggy bank. It's a little more
class.
Well,
you've got the fancy piggy bank. You've got the Arvin piggy bank. I just went very generic. So, but I'm giving away T-shirts, which if you want a T-shirt, let me know. I'm sure you don't want to wear my T-shirt on your show.
I would absolutely wear your T-shirt.
Okay. Well, I told Kale I'd wear it. If he'd give me a T-shirt from Ham Radio 360, I'd wear it on my show. I don't have a problem with that.
How's the Hamfest been going for you?
Very good. It's a lot of people. I recorded one forum this morning at 9:15.
Which one?
Dan Romanchek, KB6NU. He did a forum on how to give a one-day tech class for new amateur radio operators, people who want to get their first license. That went very well. Wasn't anything, no revelations or anything. It was just like, here's how I do it. Here you go. You know, that kind of thing.
Back in the day when I was doing classes, they're like 10 weeks long.
Yeah.
Two nights a week for 10 classes.
Yeah. So, and one of the local clubs I'm at home does them 2 weeks long, Tuesday, Thursday for 1 week and the second week.
You can get a license in the one-day class. You're not going to learn very much.
Yeah.
But
hopefully
you start learning after that. And hopefully there's some follow-up.
Did
he talk about follow-up?
Yeah, he did talk about follow-up. Yeah, he said, here's some classes you can do or some subject matters you can do for what to do after they get their license, because his theory is, you don't really start learning until you get on the air and start playing with the dials on the radio and can key up and transmit and that kind of thing. And he's right. He's right. I agree with that. I learn by doing. Some people learn by reading. I don't. I learn by doing.
And the hard part might be someone gets licensed like that. Will they get on the air? Will they get a radio? Yeah. Do they get some mentoring afterwards?
And he said that's one thing he's seen, is that sometimes they'll get a license and you'll never hear from them again. But. Yeah. He's like, you know, even if it's like a 50% turnover where you like 50% of the people who pass their tech license get on the air, then that's still a win. And I'm like, yeah, that's true. I agree with that. So.
So do you like this venue compared to the Hera Arena?
Yeah, I think I do.
Everybody tells me some pluses, some minuses.
Yeah, I think that's right. Yeah, they've got some bugs to work out.
What's your big plus?
The big plus, it's just a newer facility. There's not, you know, the parking lot and the streets are not all broken asphalt. There's not a bunch of gravel, broken gravel and cracks in the asphalt like there was at Hera. The buildings are fine, except for building 6 over there. All the buildings are nice and open and high ceilings and whatnot.
You got a booth here in the high rent district.
Well, I'm sharing with these guys here with BridgeCom.
Oh, okay. You're a part of BridgeCom.
They were going to buy one table. And they said, hey, we'll buy 2 tables and we'll sell you half of our second table, which I took up the whole second table.
You did.
But I wanted a table back there to set up the studio in the booth like you and I did, but they didn't order me one, and I think I forgot to tell them about it, which is my fault.
Yeah, I brought my own second table.
Yeah, did you? Okay.
Yeah, but I'm back in the tents. We haven't done anything back there yet, but we will tomorrow. It's about like this, maybe a little warmer.
Okay.
But if it rains, it's going to get, you know, kind of messy.
Yeah. So, anyway.
So, yeah, they'll have to do something about the tent city.
Yeah.
I think next year they'll work
on
something
better. And the parking is great, but the road to get into the Hamfest has been a challenge.
Line.
Yeah.
Now, did you come in the vendor?
I came in the flea market vendor. We got here at 6:45 this morning.
Okay.
We had no wait.
There's an indoor vendor,
that's
on the backside.
On the backside, yeah, I'm
aware
of that.
And I also had no wait at 7:15.
One guy from Texas who's a buddy of mine came by here a little bit ago, and he said it took him an hour to get here from Columbus. Once he got in line, took him an hour to get into the Hamfest.
Yeah, that's what I've been hearing.
So there's some challenges there.
Is that the big downside for you, or is there anything else? I hear the flea market is getting muddy. It's been a lot of rain.
The flea market's muddy because of the rain yesterday and this morning.
We might as well have found out the first year.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But you know what? They sold out a flea market space twice, I'm told.
But now, from now on, everyone's going to say, it's all muddy.
It's all muddy.
It might not be muddy for 10 more years.
No.
But you'll ever hear.
Yeah, you can't ever. Yeah, that's true. You're right about that. You can't ever tell about weather in Ohio any more than you can about weather in Texas. Texas is the same way.
Yeah.
So, but no, I think it's good. It's laid out more widely laid out than Hera was.
Yeah. Well, by requirement, that's where the buildings are.
It's bigger. So next year I'm going to get either a skateboard or a Segway bring with me.
Not sure they're going to let you go around on a Segway.
I went out into that tent over there, that guy selling all the LED signs and the neat trinkets and whatnot. I'm like, do you sell Segways? He's like, no. I'm like, you need to.
Yeah. That,
this would be a good place to.
If you could do the scoot arounds, maybe the Segways would be okay too. I don't know.
Yeah. So anyway.
All right. So will you be coming back next year?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think this is a success overall. This is just the first day, of course.
Yeah,
but
it's Friday. I'm looking down the aisle behind you. This is just kind of a random aisle in a random building. And that's about what you'd see at Dayton.
Oh, yeah.
At Hera.
Yeah.
Unless it was raining, which would drive everybody inside, and then it would get more crowded.
Yes, that is true. I agree with you on that.
Yeah, I'd say that the crowds look good.
Look great.
We will see what the attendance works out to be.
Right.
I don't know if they'll make that 35,000, but...
I don't know. Good question.
It would be great if they did.
Yes,
I would love it if they did, and if not this year, next year.
Right.
Because I think what... I heard a lot of people say, I'm not sure, I'll wait.
I'm going to skip a year and see what happens.
I was hoping that attitude wasn't too pervasive, because then it would be self-fulfilling prophecy of doom. So I don't think that's been a problem. And now lots of people are going to be saying, it was great.
Yeah.
And
any
holdouts will be encouraged to come.
I think you're right.
Especially when they see our shows and how
Is. We're going to be the ones that make it for them, I'm sure.
I'll bring an extra 50 people.
The amateur radio logic guys came by here earlier, and I don't think they recognized me, but I said hi to them. I was like, I watch your show. They're like, oh, great. Who are you? That's okay. I don't care.
On this show a few minutes earlier, at least as far as the video goes, I had Don Wilbanks do half my show for me.
Really?
Yeah. Well, I ran into him out by the food.
Yeah.
And then Emmett from Radio Waves walked up, and I handed them both mics, and Don interviewed Emmett.
Well, there you go. There you go. Emmett, that's that guy's name. I couldn't remember his name because he was around here all day yesterday, but we interviewed him in Orlando.
We did, yeah.
So he's got like three or four hex speeds.
Of putting that show together, by the way.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah.
I was wondering if that met with your approval.
Oh, yeah. It looks great. Well, the camera work was awesome. Oh, wait. Yeah. That was me.
that was you. Well, yeah.
Well, you did the point of view cam part pretty well.
Yeah. I think both of them turned out good.
You need to grow about another foot. Otherwise, your shot is like that for most people. But
one guy came up to me earlier. He's like, you look a lot taller on YouTube. And I'm like, I'm not sure how to take that.
The camera puts on 6 inches.
Right. I guess. I'm always sitting down, though. So,
that's true. All right. I can't tell. So, all right, we're going to move on.
Sounds good.
I'm glad we found you here.
Okay, yeah, definitely, yeah. And we'll do maybe a sit-down thing on Sunday.
Okay, and how much is it safe for me to grab from here?
You can grab as much as you want. I'm not going to yell at you. I'll yell at somebody else, but not you.
Okay, Jason, see you later.
Thanks, Gary.
I don't always wear T-shirts, but when I do, they're Ham Radio 2.0 shirts.
Hold that microphone up real close. Do you remember how to do this?
I do. Hi, Gary.
Jeff, you're at Dayton Xenia.
Yeah. I wanted to come for the inaugural kickoff here at Xenia.
Yeah, I remember fondly that you, in 2007, were the Dayton Virgin. Well, welcome to this edition of Amateur Radio Video News. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and we are at Dayton 2007. And with me for this trip is my friend Jeff, AC4ZO. This is Jeff's first trip to Dayton. Yes, Jeff is a Dayton version. So I'm going to kind of let him lead the tour this year.
Is that when it was, 07? I was wondering when it was.
This is the 10th anniversary of Jeff the Dayton Virgin.
Yes.
So
wait, we all are Xenia virgins, yeah. I suppose.
Now, have you missed one since then?
Yes, last year. I missed last year. It's the only one I've missed since
9 out of 10. 07.
Yeah.
9 out of 10 ain't bad. Do you remember how this television stuff went?
No, remind me.
It was mostly you. Oh. I stayed behind the camera. I did an introduction, and then you did all the interviews that first year.
That would be fun. I haven't really talked to anybody. I only just got here minutes ago. I arrived early this morning, but have been in a test session ever since. And we just came across from the test session. Test session's going really well.
That was what I was going to ask. How are they doing?
They're doing really well.
They're making bacon.
They do some very interesting organizational things to move things along quickly. And man, does it work.
So have you met your replacement?
I met Marty just a couple of minutes ago. I've been hearing about him, but I've only just met him a few minutes ago for the first time. I like him.
he's a brash young kid.
Good.
You know, in 2007, we were both brash young kids.
I know.
We've gotten older.
Well, we were only in our 50s then.
Yep. Folks' shoulders are encroaching on my camera space here.
Oh, well, they're talking.
Yeah.
Enjoying themselves. Everybody's enjoying themselves. Came over hoping to find food straight away. I heard the food situation was much improved, but there were long lines everywhere.
It's so improved, everybody wants to get some.
Yeah,
so
we looked at the lines and decided to come straight in and start shopping right away. And that's the first door I came in, and there you were right inside the door.
How fortunate for all of us.
So I've seen nothing yet, but I'm about to.
All right, so asking you what you think of the Hamfest is useless because...
Too soon. I haven't seen a map, so I don't know what building we're in. I believe the tents are building 6 because you told me that, I think.
Yeah.
And that's all I know. I'm guessing this must be building 5.
This is building 1.
Building 1.
Yeah. It's the Maxim... they've named them all.
Maxim Hall. I saw a big sign.
Okay.
Yep. Interesting.
But this is building 1, so.
Okay, good.
All right, we'll go look at the Hamfest.
Okay, all right.
Marty,
it's nice to meet you. I'm glad you're here. Okay, bye, Gary.
See ya. I'm going to shoot video of your chest.
Best offer I've had all day. Unfortunately, this shirt is 24 years old. I actually had it before I met KA2DEW, and I'm here, so
the
let's
next,
all do the math.
The
let's
next husband... Math. Who was been on Ham Radio Now recently? The next husband was the ham.
That's correct.
The next husband was the ham.
We don't get it.
Actually, this antenna cranks itself up, so it's. And I can bring it back down. Of course, you know when the weather's bad, obviously. This year, this Hamvention happens. The only place I wear it is right here at Hamvention. This year is 20 years old. And me being the club president, Darren.
It's been on the cover of the newspaper.
Oh, yes, yes.
And I think it's probably the most photographed, single photographed thing at Hamvention.
Probably has been.
There I am on TV. Focus. Focus. Oh, might not focus that close. All right, I've ditched the kid. Marty couldn't take it anymore. So this is that middle building. I forget what the name of it is, but it's something. It's got a lot of the international stuff and organizations. JARL is right back there. DARC, Germany. Radio Amateurs of Canada. Somehow RF Kit got in the middle of it. And HRO is right there. That can't be all they've got. That's not nearly enough space. RSGB. Some place called Arizona. And some ARL stuff. This isn't the main ARL area. And I see Boy Scouts back there. So this is kind of a mixed bag building. Another metal roof. And I think I'm probably almost done here. Let me see if there's anything unusual in here that I've missed. And we'll move on. Okay, so I think this is the main ARL area. In fact, I'm sure it is. The Expo Light. It just, you can't see it all from one spot because it's separated by a set of curtains. So it started back with that public safety, or public service booth. And then this is the piece in the middle. They're testing radios again down there. I didn't bring my Bofeng, but I've got my TYT DMR radio with me. Let me see if I can see how spurious that is.
Now we have two celebrities, Bob.
Yes, two celebrities.
Hi,
so,
Gary.
So I finally got, I finally edited the interview we did at Dayton a couple years ago.
Oh, okay.
And stuck it on the end of a talk about the TYT and a Bofeng that I had.
Yes.
So you made it on the air, and we're going to check my TYT and see how it does.
Sure.
I've got it in analog.
Is this a DMR radio?
It's a DMR, but I got it in analog on 446.
All right, very, very good. Now, mind you, in the FCC rules, it's FCC part 97307E. Only pertains to amateur transmitters like between 30 and 225 megahertz.
So I can be as spurious as I want.
Yeah, spurious emission, but you know, use good engineering practice.
And that's what we're here to find out.
Exactly. So we'll take a look at that. We're going to put the stop frequency on the scope, and let's see, to 1.5 gigahertz. Okay. And then we're going to transmit single sweep. Here we go across. Yeah, let's see what we got. There's the fundamental. Sweeping, sweeping, sweeping. Oh, there's the second harmonic. Not much to worry about. Et cetera, et cetera. And that's it. So let's take a little measurement here. We'll go with our little marker. Okay, set it up. The delta is the difference. Moving the marker over to the harmonic. Let's get a quick measurement.
Okay.
And your second harmonic is down 59 dB.
So not bad.
Good engineering practice.
TYT, Chinese.
Yeah, well, many of the Chinese transceivers are compliant.
Are they getting better?
Well, I can't say for sure. They've had a lot of other brands that are consistently not compliant. Some by missing the mark by a lot. And so I can say quite confidently, talk on your favorite 2-meter repeater and launch a cruise missile at the same time. Just be careful. We're here to educate you. Can't tell you can't use the radio.
All right.
All right, but at least you know you have harmonics and do the right thing.
Thank you, Bob.
You're welcome.
Who are you?
Matthias Alpha Juliet 4 Bravo Bravo.
Here we go.
And Bob Allison, WB1GCM.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it. Thanks for doing this.
You're welcome.
Cool. So I can be as spurious as I want, but I've been tested. And this is the final aisle of ARL, with the booth right in front of me being Ham Radio Science Citizen Investigation. They're wearing white lab coats. I think I'm going to have to find out what that's all about. And the league doesn't nearly have the presence here that they did in HERA. after they finally established the ARL Expo at National Convention, I don't know, 5-6 years ago. But it's bigger than the couple of tables they used to have. So I don't know. Let's see what citizen investigation is all about. CSI ARRL. Who are you?
Hi, I'm Nathaniel Frizzell, W2NAF.
And do you know what my next question is going to be?
What do I do?
Well, no, but close. What is ham radio science citizen investigation? I've never heard of that.
Ah, so this is an organization that looks to join the amateur radio community with the professional science community. So I was an amateur radio operator first. I got my ham license when I was in high school, and then I went to grad school, and I liked ham radio so much I got my PhD in ionospheric science.
Wait, this guy is too smart for me to be talking to him. I got to stop right now. Okay, in computer science?
Ionospheric science, ionospheric physics.
Atmospheric, okay.
Yeah, so I actually study the ionosphere. And so when I was in grad school, I was looking at reverse beacon network data, and I had a few friends, and Ethan Miller, KGU, and a few other people, and I said, hey, this is really cool. Maybe we can actually learn something about the ionosphere and do studies using this reverse beacon network data. And so I took that, and we eventually made this ham sciences investigation to try and join what we're doing using this ham radio generated data with the ham radio community.
So the beacon network is where it starts. Is there an ending, or is it self-contained like that?
So that is where it started, but it goes much further than that. We're also looking at using WhisperNet data and PSK reporter data, and we're also going to have a solar eclipse QSO party where we're going to have a big operating event to have people operate in a contest-like manner, and that data generated by those networks and also by user-submitted logs, so radio operator-submitted logs, will be used to help study the ionosphere. And hopefully we'll have a really fun operating event all at the same time.
Is there any expected effect on the ionosphere for the eclipse?
Yes. So in the shadow of the eclipse, we expect photoionization to decrease, and so the ionospheric densities to decrease. And so we expect the higher bands to cut out, and we expect enhancements in propagation on the lower bands.
Can the ionosphere react that fast to a fairly rapid change?
Yes, it can. Previous data has shown that the ionosphere for an eclipse, you'll see changes. It actually is a little bit more of a gradual change than you might expect, because you don't have totality right away. You're going to start with a partial eclipse, it'll go into totality and then come out of the partial eclipse. So some previous data that I've looked at will show an effect in the ionosphere that could last as long as 4 hours.
And will bands like 20 meters, 15 meters? 15 meters is in good shape anyway, because the sunspot cycle is poor, but at the highest usable frequencies available on that day, you expect them to kind of go dead?
I think they would drop off a bit. And I also think that maybe the lower frequencies, maybe we'll see higher signal-to-noise ratios. Maybe those signals will go a little bit farther.
Has this been ever tested before during an eclipse?
There have been a number of experiments similar to this before. The United Kingdom, they've had some eclipses in the past. They had a solar eclipse QSO party a couple years ago. And back in 1999, they had a total solar eclipse where they did some experiments with amateur radio with people listening to AM broadcast stations. And there's some very nice information out about that.
Now, the eclipse is total for only a small portion of the ground. Is it hitting the ionosphere more broadly, or is it still a narrow band?
It will hit the ionosphere more broadly, but it's still going to be fairly narrow in comparison to the whole continent.
But still enough to see a change in propagation?
Absolutely, you'll definitely see a change in propagation.
Okay, so I didn't want this to be all the eclipse show. Where else you guys go, and how do ordinary hams get involved beyond this activity?
So ordinary hams might go and set up reverse beacon network receiver nodes. We have some information on our website, hamsci.org, on how to do that. And those nodes can generate data any day, not just on the eclipse, that we would be able to look at and have a better understanding. Same thing if you operate PSK31. Make sure that your systems are set to submit your QSOs to PSK Reporter, or go operate WhisperNet. So those are some ways you can participate.
And you guys are collecting the data. Where can we aggregate it? Where can we see it?
So we have a number of people within our group who are working on analyzing it. And as we come up with good analysis, we present it at conferences. We'll post that on our website, hamsci.org. And we will also share that through QST and the American Radio Relay League.
Are you seeing a lot of interest from hams, or is it like me? I've never heard of you before.
Well, we're still fairly new, but yes, we have a lot of interest from hams. We have probably about 80 people who are consist of both ham radio operators and professional researchers who are in some way involved in this project. We have over 100 people signed up for our Eclipse QSO Party listserv, so it's gaining a lot of momentum. I'd also like to note that, so like you said, this isn't just about the eclipse. So we're constantly looking for new ways to use amateur radio to study the ionosphere. And so there's room for people, you know, if you have an idea, you can contact us and we can, if it's a good idea, we can promote it through our website, help bring that scientific idea out. We can connect you with people who might have more of a scientific knowledge on a particular subject than maybe you do, or maybe you would, you know, have an idea that we haven't thought of yet. So we're very interested in all sorts of input.
So I'm trying to get a handle on the citizen part of it. Is the hams are the citizens?
That's right. The hams are the citizens. So and they participate in different levels. So some of it can just be regular operations, like participating in the QSO party. Some of the citizen signs can be the ham radio operators setting up things like the reverse beacon network, which was completely done just voluntarily by the ham radio community. We also have some hams that have background in data analysis, and they've come to us and they're like, I want a project to work on. And so we work on them. We work with them on helping them to get a hold of this data, identify some research goals. And so just for fun, these people are actively working on analyzing this data and trying to find out how we can make this more useful.
So how big are you guys? How many folks are involved?
We have involvement of people from roughly 20 to 25 institutions around the world. I would say our core group, I work at the New Jersey Institute of Technology. I have 5 undergrad students working for me right now, and myself. We have there's a research group at Virginia Tech, which has, Virginia Tech is the principal investigating institution on the Eclipse project, so they have a team of about 10 people working on this.
Look at all the fun they're putting up that big satellite, too.
Oh, they're having lots of fun with that. So there's quite a bit of involvement.
All right. So from your end of things, it sounds like very research-driven, very collegiate. If someone wants to be more than just feeding you information, if they would like to get in on the research, not a lot of people are going to want to do that, but some might. How do they do that?
It's very simple. You can contact us at hamsci@hamsci.org. Which you can find that address at our website, hamsci.org. And if you tell us a little bit about yourself and what your interests are, we will try and identify or give you suggestions of what you might be able to do. And if you find that's something that you're interested in, we'll work with you to keep moving things along for you.
All right. Very interesting. Not what I was really expecting, and pretty cool. Not CSI Ham Radio, Ham SCI. I got that right.
That's right, HamSci, the Ham Radio Science Citizen Investigation.
And you have a PhD in ham radio.
I do, yes. You can look in my dissertation, it's online. There's a whole chapter about the reverse beacon network and solar flares.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Gary.
So I'm looking at this new 6400. This is brand new at the show, right?